It's pretty much the final talk of the year, the master's programs and the doctoral program. Thanks, Isabella, for accepting our invitation. I want to just introduce briefly Isabella. She's a full professor of general psychology and psychology of communication in the Departamento de Filosofía, Comunicaciones y Capolo in the Universidad de Madrid. She's an internationally renowned scholar in the field of multimodal communication and cultivates multiple interests in the field of linguistics, cognitive psychology, and social emotions. She started her career some years ago in 1974 as a linguist, and then progressively she became interested in the gesture studies, and she started collaborating with many psychologists, and especially Cristiano Castelfranchi in the CNR in Rome. She's a very prolific scholar. She has analyzed many issues related to multimodal communication. She's published 6 books and published the webpage, 5 edited books, more than 150 articles on these issues, combining pragmatic aspects of language and emotions, social relations, verbal and multimodal communication. And she's lately been very interested and also participated in a European research project related to embodied pages and how to incorporate all this research into the embodied pages development. And more recently, she has applied the work of multimodal communication and the analysis of politicians' talk. So that's part of what she's going to talk about today, and thanks for being here and very much.
Thank you for the presentation, and sorry for not talking either Catalan or Spanish. I always feel quite ashamed when I'm with an audience which is Romance language, I cannot stop them, but English. So I think it's a defeat for identity of Mediterranean and Latin people. That's the problem of linguistic imperialism. I'm talking about connection between linguistics and multimodal communication, because as you have heard, I was a linguist many years ago, but it was very difficult to have linguists be interested and think that body communication is important. So it's not easy to be a linguist and deal with these things. This is why many, something that in Italian we say mosche bianche, very strange beasts, are linguists that care prosody and gestures like Luis Paredo, prosody like Pilar and so on. So it's just to give some courage, if you need it, to work in these interesting fields, even if they are not very well acknowledged and very well loved in your academic field. In fact, I was obliged to transform myself, to put on a different dress, a dress of a psychologist, because I couldn't be accepted by linguists. So I say that the Western speculation from many years back, some centuries, let's say to 2000 years, is caring about language written, formally written in that oral language, and started to study lexicon and to make up lexicons of all the languages in the world and learn grammars of them. But communication is not only words. It's a lot of things in the body that make things. And so our body is composed by many parts. We have a face, which also has a part with eyes, which includes eyebrows, eyelids, eyes, eye sockets. And all of them have, may have a communication function. For instance, these parts make up the communication system of gaze. We might also think of the communication system of nose. As soon as we find that we have at least two different signals made by the nose, for instance, wrinkling your nose to show that your something is filthy, might be a signal. And so it might be a part of a system of communication. In any case, we have jaws, lips, teeth, which makes for morphemes and phonemes, and so we make words, positive intonation, and we also make grimaces, smiles, laugh, and so on. And we have hands by which we make gestures. And with all our body, we make movements, posture, and proxemic special placement, and so on. And also we have a non-resident system. Non-resident because it dwells not only in one part of the body, but in all our body. We have touch, because we can touch people with a communicative purpose, with various parts of our body. For instance, in a kick, I use a leg, a foot. In a caress, I use a hand. In a kiss, I use my mouth and so on. So if we accept that we have as many communication systems as are the organs of our body, and not only organs, but the whole the body, we can first distinguish different kinds of communication systems. One kind is the one that I put here, which is codified communication systems. Codified means that there is a two-sided representation in our mind that tells that this is a signal and this is its meaning. And so I have a set of signal-meaning pairs that are rules of correspondence that are steadily represented in my memory and in other people's memory. And so in this kind, in this case, I can talk of a lexicon, which is a codified, a memorized set of pairs of signal and meanings. But in other cases, we have a creative communication system. For instance, when I make a pantomime, or when you are confronting another person who is not of the same of your language, and so you have to communicate with him or her, you make gestures. But your gestures cannot be gestures that you do know that he can understand, because you don't know if he can understand this gesture either. So you make creative gestures. You make necessary iconic gestures that give the idea of what you're meaning. And so you make them from pantomime. So pantomime is a creative system of communication. So if we wanted to make an agenda for Brontemeyer studies, we should discover the creative rules of creative communication systems. For instance, understand the inference rules that start from a signal and understand its meaning. If I say that house has a beautiful terrace, you can understand that it's a triangular terrace also. And so you just understand from the similarity from what I gesture and what I mean. And in the other cases, when I have a codified system, I have to find out the correspondences between signals and meanings in those codified systems. But if we try to approach body language, by psychologists. For instance, this was the reason why I had to become a psychologist. But they do not have a linguistic approach. For instance, in a linguistic approach, you should not only find out the lexicon of a codified system, that is, the correspondences between what means what, but also how this what is made, which is, what is the phonology, what is the alphabet of these signals. And so, some people try to find out in these lexicons the phonologies of bodily systems. The first one who tried to do this job was a scholar who was William Stocky, first in 1960, who tried to study the sign languages of the deaf. And he studied the American Sign Language. And he found out, and he tried, and he managed to demonstrate that the sign languages of the deaf do have a phonology. But for the theology, because they are periods, they are not phonemes. So, in the same way, we might say that there is a phonology not only in the signs used by deaf, but also in the gestures that we do use. And so we can make a chorology of the gesture of hearing people, not only deaf signers. And we can find also, why not, a phonology of hearing, an ontology, a phonology of touch, an ontology, and so on, a prosopology, a cephalology, a stomatology, a phonology of mouth, why not? So, the first two I try to find them. For the other, we have to think about. And so, how can we make a phonology of gestures, for instance, of Italian symbolic gestures or Catalan symbolic gestures like Luis Paglietto studied? My proposal is to find out the parameters. The parameters are criteria of classification, and each of them has a small number of values. For instance, if I make a gesture like this, which is a typical gesture, which means, what do you mean? Or that I don't agree with what you are saying. It is a real question, but also a rhetorical question, which means I don't agree with you. This is made with a handshake, with this handshake. But it is also made in a location, which is the place in the space where I make this gesture. Because in Italian, I also have gestures that make, are you mad? Or you say, please give me something to eat. I'm very hungry. And so I have the same handshake, but a different location, which is in the forehead. And so, the first thing that one can do is to find out the parameters and the values of a gestural communication system. So for instance, I picked up the parameters of signs in sign languages and tried to apply them to the gestures of Italian gestures, hearing gestures. And other people also made the same thing, percent gestures, who started the original sign language by Campion, and Capri about French gestures and so on. So for instance, in the Italian gesture I found out 40 handshakes, because we have a lot of handshakes. And we need gestures very much. And 33 locations and so on. But there is a very important parameter of gesture, which is movement, which is a very complex and very articulated parameter. Because we must say what is the direction, the path, and the manner. other gesture, or movement in gesture. So, I also have some sub-parameters of the parameter of movement, which have been called the expressivity parameters, that are how ample is a gesture, how long does it take to do it, temporary sense, and then fluidity, which means that it's very soft and very fluid, or else very jerky and very sudden changes in direction. And then it might be a powerful, very strong gesture or very low gesture. And it may also be repeated many times or not. And so for instance, if you see this that we can use for learning on a language, not of the body, on a vocal language, I can wonder if that item is acceptable in that concept, and what does it mean, what are the synonyms of that word, what are the, if that word is ambiguous, and so on. These are all Chomsky's speaker judgments that I can use also for a gaze. I can tell if a gaze means this or that because other thing. I can tell if that kind of gaze is ambiguous and it has more than one meaning and so on. And which meaning is then I have literary sources like seeing on a novel, for instance, when it is mentioned that that person in the novel, he made a vague gesture. What does it mean to make a vague gesture? And so I can find what gesture might be there, and so on. And then I have ethnosemantics, which means how to see how that communication system is mentioned in this language. For instance, in Italian, we may have many ways to mention gaze, occhiata, sguardo. In English, we can have gaze, stare, sheep's eyes, which is making sheep's eyes is when one is like falling in love with someone. So, or we can have looking down on someone. It's a way of showing poetry, of showing contempt to the other, and so on. So if we find the names with which it is named, the communicative acts in that communicative systems, this is a good way to understand much of these communicative systems. Then we have survey asking people how do they use that gesture or if that gaze means something, or experimental ways, observation, and then deductive nature method, and then using the simulation of a particular communication system over an embodied conversation agent, for instance, an artificial agent which is an interface in a computer, to see whether what does it mean that particular case, for instance. So, I'll show you just two examples of deductive method and maybe of the simulation method and experimental method about games. For instance, in the deductive method, we can start deductively by hypothesizing and taxonomic meanings, deducing subclasses of these meanings, and looking for items that in that communication system fill out in those slots. For instance, I think that for all the things that we communicate in any communication system, we can find three types of information that we provide to other people. Information on the world, information on the sender's mind, what we are thinking and feeling about that which we are talking about at the moment, and information on the sender's identity. So for instance, information of the world concerns objects, persons, events, space and time relationships, and it provided, for instance, in linguistic in languages by words and syntax, but also by iconic gesture or iconic gaze. By iconic gesture, I am telling you that I'm going to refer to that person there or to that thing around in the environment. By identity information, I mean that if you see my face and if you hear my voice, you can understand also that I am not a child of 2 years. And you understand that I am a woman, not a man, and so on. So there are some information that are given by my face, by my voice, and my body. And then you can have information about the beliefs, the goals, and the emotions that I'm feeling about the things I'm talking about. Now, for instance, if I say it's obvious, it means that, or if I use this gesture, which is warm up, open hand, it means that what I am talking about is something quite obvious, that everybody can see, everybody can know. So I am providing information about the degree of certainty that I have about the thing I am talking about. For instance, if I snap my thumb by the middle finger, it means I'm trying to remember something. I'm trying to retrieve this from my long-term memory. So this gesture means that I am giving you information about from where I take the information I am providing. This is just to give some 2 examples. Let's go to see some examples of gaze. For instance, in gaze, these are gaze types that inform about beliefs. For instance, this is a gaze of perplexity. You see this raised eyebrows. But raised, that are somewhat different from surprise. So in surprise you have also wide open eyes. Instead here you have not completely open eyes. Here instead you have a frown, which means I am concentrating on this and thinking of this, but very focusing on this. And when I look up, means I am trying to make inferences, to plan something, to find new information in my, and I'm not very intelligent in this game, because it lasts too long, it's not, it takes too much to make inferences. This is a typical gaze that some students make while being put a question on oral exam. Then you can have a challenging gaze, which is challenging, defying someone by looking him in his eyes. Instead, immediately after, you can have a dismay because he's a politician who was formerly very powerful, but now he's accused in a trial. So he first tries to show his very self-confidence, but then he has a moment of dismay because he's being chased by the conservative. And then so there are emotions also that are conveyed by the games. We try to make an empirical study by using an artificial face, which is the face of Derrida, an embodied conversation made by Catherine de la Chaux in Paris, first in Roma and then in Paris. And this was this face library was a library in which you can set all points of the face in whatever position you want. So we could close eyelids a bit, we could make raised eyebrows, but also frowning eyebrows, and so on. We could do given parameter of gaze, that the values in subparameter of gaze not only have a phonemic, but even a morphemic pertinence. They are morpheme, not only phoneme, in that they are not devoid of meaning completely. And so we, since it's possible to find minimal pairs between kinds of gaze, types of gaze, we did the following. We kept the same eye position, eyes direction, and eyebrows. So we had this very same face of Greta, and we only varied the aperture of upper eyelids. We only saw how was the eyelids, whether wide open or normal, the fold, or closed eyelids. And so, if you do this, you see that these are the same raised eyebrows, everything is the same, but the position of the upper eyelid. So, in this case, we have a surprised Greta. In this case, we have a perplexed Greta. And in this case, we have a contentious Greta in our hypothesis. We made the hypothesis that the meaning of these three different items of gaze were these. And so we asked people, we made a questionnaire with 15 items of gaze with instructors. They were multiple choice, but they also had the choice other. They might say that the meaning of that particular gaze was different from the one proposed by us. So we were proposing the true one, the one that was our hypothesis, and then some instructors, and then we also left an open possibility. And so the results are that, for instance, in warning, 90% of people found out that that meant really warning, and so on, and then the sign, I hate you, figure, and so on. So, more or less, warning, desire, hate were the most correctly checked. And then, less than three, in conflict and perplexed were not so guessed appropriately, and around 1.5 the others. But the nice thing is that the destructors that were semantically opposite or incompatible were never chosen. For instance, when our hypothesis was that the gaze meant calm and indifferent, the destructor scare was never chosen. And it came out that there is always some common element between the target meaning and the chosen destructors of the open answers. So in these cases, also some elements on the signal side. What does it mean? Let's see this. Okay. Let's see unperplexed. Here, the target, which is the meaning that we hypothesized, was I am perplexed. And so, self-confident was chosen 32%, perplexed 25%, but the other destructors that were chosen were contentious, anxious, poor, and superiority. So if we see the meanings of all these things, we can find that in all of them there are some components of meaning, some semantic features that are positive sense of evaluation, a negative attitude toward the other, a negative evaluation of the other, and the social distance. So, you see that, in fact, also in the gaze that meant these the signals that were in common with the signal complex. So there was some correspondence both on the side of the meanings and on the side of the signals. This made us, in a sense, conclude that the obtenes are not only phonemes, but they are, in some sense, some morphemes, because they, in them, there is not something common only in the meaning, but also in the signal. Not only in the signal, but also on the meaning. In fact, this was found also about gestures, because gestures also are not only the careens, are not only plain phonologic, they are not just because if you take a handshake like extended in the finger, it always gives in all the signals, in all the gestures that have this handshake, they all share a common semantic element of uniqueness. There is always something common, which is that they mean something unique. But also, in some cases, a value in another branch, which is the branch of movement, can be the same, can be a value which is not only phonematic, but even morphematic. Because a progressive movement from left to right means that you are going from less to more, from minus to plus, and so on. And also, this is also in a gesture of Catalan emblems also. The emblems for folia, for something mad, someone who is mad, you always have the head as a collocation, which means that the location of head has the value of something connected with the mind, brain, or something. So, so this by itself base strength again. And this, in fact, and let's see this other one. So, doing like this means piano. So, the movement which is not so sudden, not so jerky, so the parameter of fluidity of the movement tells us that it is piano. So, this is to come back to the to what we found about gaze, for instance. We found for gaze that the so-called phonemes of gaze, the octaves, are not in fact phonemes but morphemes of gaze. And also in these cases we find out that even in the sub-parameter of movement of gestures, we have sometimes only the muscular tension, in sometimes only the shape of the gesture, sometimes only the location, for instance, low instead of high, which tells you the meaning. So gestures are morphemes. I can, if you want to stop, or else.
The field of semiotics as a whole, right? At least certain sectors of linguistics. And I guess here I start to worry a bit about the question of how, so even if one wants to defend that there's kind of a climb across different kinds of semiotic systems, that there isn't a sharp distinction, which of course is a matter of huge debate. There are nonetheless things that are very different about human language systems that are not shared by other sorts of semiotic systems, even if you look at something as similar, it would seem, to human language as an emoji. And so I guess I'm wondering a bit about how you see your program in the context of this larger issue. For instance, you know, you talk about the phonology of these gestures. And of course there are phonology and there is phonology in the gesture of sign language systems, but then would you talk about brushstroke in painting as phonology? You know, so I would sort of appreciate a more general kind of program statement with respect to how you see this work in relation to what people have sort of claimed makes human language language as opposed to the vast variety of other communicative systems which clearly do have structure and do have, are obviously used to convey meaning.
Well, in fact, what I am interested in is not to distinguish disciplines, but if you want to pick up what disciplines give me in order to study humans. This is in a sense the approach of cognitive science. The cognitive science is by definition a non-disciplinary science because it does not stick to one discipline or so. So I don't care if what I'm saying is semiotic. For instance, the brush in a painting, it depends on whether while brushing in that moment you want to provide that perceivable effect about the special meaning of that very, very particular item of body language. But at the same time, I'm also interested in seeing how it is used and it works. For instance, in persuasion. For instance, the second part of the serial was about trying to demonstrate that if I can find out those that I call the seeds, the features, the semantic features of something in the meaning of some signals, I can count, compute, see how many of these meanings are present in the multimodal discourse of Mussolini, for example. So I can, recently I'm working on charisma, on the charismatic leaders, why are they charismatic, and what are their kinds of charisma. And we found out that there are many different kinds of charisma, which can be articulated into many, some little pieces of meanings. For instance, when you are very clear, for instance, when you are a teacher that are very, very clear in his talking, and you make iconic gestures, they are a fact of life. The very fact that you use an iconic gesture means that you are a clear teacher. So if I mean, if I find out, for instance, that the a part of how people see the charisma of the teacher is clarity, then I find out that that teacher is quite charismatic because he is clear. If I see that he makes some gestures that convey clarity, that are an element of clarity. Okay. And at the same, for instance, when you saw that person who was doing very wide gestures and like this, he's a Sicilian and he's also the former fascist party, so he's quite a bossy person. And so he is bossy in his gestures because he has very wide gestures, because he has strength, violence,